We're going to be discussing the realm of four orders of supernatural travel.
And it's interesting because I looked up crabs represent strongholds.
Today, I want to talk to you about the spirit of Python.
Congregation, just give them the best fire that you got. We just released the fire.
My message is about demonic intelligence.
And Joshua's going to be sharing on power portals.
Milestones or keys that got you to the place that you are today. I mean, maybe you could just run through those. I mean, there's so many.
What are you?
Welcome today to YPJ. We're going to be talking about not despising the small beginnings.
Everyone, I'd like you to meet Dr. Henry Pym, also known as Ant-Man.
Hi there. Funny, I thought you'd all be taller.
So this is such an important concept as you're going after the prophetic, because God loves to start things embryonic.
I'm supposed to stay subatomic to make sure none of the particles escape.
Loves to start something that is so, needs so much of him in it, that it creates a gap between what's possible now today and it even manifesting in your lifetime. And he did this with Mary when he gave her that seed form of Jesus when she was pregnant with the Christ within her. I mean, no one thought that a natural woman was going to have the Messiah birth through their you know, being.
This talk is getting very icky, the seed form of Christ and all. That notwithstanding, Sean here is about to indulge in a popular and, yes, sadly, prolific error in preaching today, and that is to take a character in the Bible and assume that everything that happened to that character will happen to us. To take characters in the Bible as our prototypes for us to be made into the image of them, but the person we're made into the image to is image of is Christ. We're being conformed to his image, not to David's or Moses's or Gideon's or Peter's or Mary's. When you read the text, the angel says, "Blessed are you, Mary, among women." See, it's a singular thing. It's happening once. Mary is favored among all women because no other woman would have this happen to her. Every believer doesn't give birth to Christ upon their conversion. But Sean here isn't even talking about that. He's not talking about conversion. He's not talking about Christ. He's going to be saying that every believer gives birth to a dream, and it starts small, but the Holy Spirit comes and makes your little dreams bigger.
And I think it's so profound that it took him 30 years before maturing, before he began to manifest the ministry that God had called him to.
30 years before Jesus began to manifest the ministry that God had called him to. That's a weird thing to say. Does Sean believe, like his buddies Todd White and Bill Johnson, that Jesus was not born God, but that he attained his godness? I don't know. It sounds very suspect.
30 years. What was he doing in those hidden years? We don't exactly know, but I know they were all foundational and important. And I don't know if Jesus was like a cap at the stall, like, "I'm ready, Father, I'm ready, let's do this." Or if he enjoyed those 30 years each day and was like, this is perfect. But I know that human nature, many times we get pregnant in our spirit with something. We know God wants to do something in our lifetime. Maybe.
Is this a joke?
Have you gotten pregnant in your spirit with something? No? What's wrong with you? Haven't you read the writings of the apostles sent by Christ to teach us all about him, where they wrote so much about getting pregnant in your spirit with something? They didn't, you know.
It's a project, like a music CD or a movie or a television show. Maybe it's something like birth a family. We want to have a wife or a husband if you're a woman and you want a husband, or a man if you want a wife. You want a family. You want to birth that family. Maybe you're 20 years old going, "Where is my spouse? I want to start this thing." There's all these things that we want to do. Maybe it's a business, an entrepreneur, whatever it is that God's put inside of you. It's going to take God to bring it into fullness.
No, no, stop!
God puts these things inside of us. He puts his Holy Spirit inside of us. This is what the apostles teach. And his Holy Spirit makes us, well, he makes us holy. He's the Holy Spirit, you see. He's not the music spirit. He's not the business spirit. He's not the movie spirit, not the TV spirit, not the YouTube spirit, not the fertility spirit. He's the Holy Spirit. He makes us like the Holy One, and the Holy One is Jesus.
And we don't want to despise the stage of growth we're at, especially when it's uncomfortable, because what happens is sometimes we get such a reach for tomorrow and what it's going to look like in its fully manifested form that we don't enjoy who God is today or who we are today. And this is the day that God's made. We have to be glad and be able to rest in this day.
That's Psalm 118. Jesus sang it the night of his death.
Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, because his mercy endureth forever. Let Israel now say that his mercy endureth forever. Let the house of Aaron now say that his mercy endureth forever. Let them now that fear the Lord say that his mercy endureth forever. I called upon the Lord in distress. The Lord answered me and set me in a large place. The Lord is on my side. I will not fear. What can man do unto me? The Lord taketh my part with them that help me. Therefore shall I see my desire upon them that hate me. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in princes. All nations compassed me about, but in the name of the Lord will I destroy them. They compassed me about, yea, they compassed me about, but in the name of the Lord I will destroy them. They compassed me about like bees. They are quenched as the fire of thorns, for in the name of the Lord I will destroy them. Thou hast thrust sore at me that I might fall, but the Lord helped me. The Lord is my strength and song, and has become my salvation. The voice of rejoicing and salvation is in the tabernacles of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord doeth valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord doeth valiantly. I shall not die, but live, and declare the works of the Lord. The Lord hath chastened me sore, but he hath not given me over unto death. Open to me the gates of righteousness. I will go into them, and I will praise the Lord. This gate of the Lord into which the righteous shall enter, I will praise thee, for thou hast heard me, and art become my salvation. The stone which the builders refused is become the headstone of the corner. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes.
Sound familiar? Yes, that's Jesus.
This is the day which the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Save now, I beseech thee, O Lord. O Lord, I beseech thee, send now prosperity. Blessed be he that cometh in the name of the Lord. We have blessed you out of the house of the Lord. God is the Lord which hath showed us light. Bind the sacrifice with cords, even unto the horns of the altar. Thou art my God, and I will praise thee. Thou art my God. I will exalt thee. O give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever.
So it's not really about your little dreams. It is about a day the Lord had prepared since before the beginning of time, when he would send his son to suffer and die for the sins of his people.
To rejoice in this day, to enjoy living in the midst of it not being in its fullness of what God's put in our imaginations and our heart, that it will be one day, we have to still like today, because this is the day that's important. This is the only day we're guaranteed. Everything else, we're guaranteed eternity and we're guaranteed today, but we're not guaranteed tomorrow. We don't know what tomorrow's going to look like. We could, you know, have an accident or have something happen, but today we can live in our fullness.
So, you know, get out there and make that dream happen. Yeah, the Bible doesn't say that anywhere.
And so that helps us to treasure the people God's put in our lives. It helps us to treasure what we're working on or doing right now. It helps us to actually pray in faith for things we do need breakthrough for in the immediate. As a matter of fact, I don't know if you know this, I've said it before on this show, but most of the promise and potential prophecies that were given in the Old Testament and New Testament were for the now or the immediate future, not the long, long-term future.
Wait, what did he say?
But most of the promise and potential prophecies that were given in the Old Testament and New Testament were for the now or the immediate future, not the long, long-term future.
All of the Old Testament prophecies were fulfilled in Jesus. You know who said that? Jesus.
Now behold, two of them were traveling that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they talked together of all these things which had happened. So it was, while they conversed and reasoned, that Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were restrained, so that they did not know him. And he said to them,
"What kind of conversation is this that you have with one another as you walk and are sad?"
Then the one whose name was Cleopas answered,
"Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem? And have you not known the things which happened there in these days?"
"What things?"
"The things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, besides all this, today is the third day since these things happened. Yes, and certain women of our company who arrived at the tomb early astonished us. When they did not find his body, they came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. And certain of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said. But him they did not see."
"O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory?"
And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself.
The Old Testament is not about us. It's about Jesus. It really is. And just as an aside, don't you love Cleopas' southern accent in this audio version? But anyway, Sean says most of the prophecies in the Old Testament are about here and now. If that's true, then what do we make of the two disciples? I mean, they were concerned about their here and now, very concerned, full of despair, the text says. And Jesus showed them in the Old Testament the things concerning their here and now. I don't think Sean knows what he's talking about. I mean, you can call me a hater, but I don't.
And God did that because he knew he put his nature inside of us, and he knew it was timeless, which means we don't want to wait for anything. We want it to be now.
Okay, there's so much wrong with that. God did not put his nature in us. That's what Sean's buddies Todd White and Bill Johnson believe. We don't have the attributes of God. He's making us into the image of Jesus, the one who saved us. But we are not becoming him. This is a process called sanctification, and it is a process. The Bible teaches that it's a lifelong process. It doesn't happen in the now. It is accomplished in heaven because God has decreed it, in the same way that Paul could write that Christ was crucified from the foundation of the world. Now, in 2 Peter 1, we do read something about the divine nature. Let's take a look at it. Let's actually read something God said rather than listen to some guy talk. It's a novel idea, but we'll give it a shot. I really believe we can read and understand the things God said to us.
"Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior Jesus Christ."
Those who have been saved by the righteousness of Christ, who have been justified in the sight of God through faith in the Holy One of God, whose righteousness alone is pleasing in the sight of God.
"Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, according as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust."
Partakers or participators in the divine nature. What is Peter talking about here? We participate in our own sanctification, or the process. The promise he just mentioned that we might be made holy. We participate in our own sanctification, as Peter goes on to say.
"And beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience. And to patience, godliness, and to godliness, brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he that lacketh these things is blind and cannot see afar off, and hath forgotten that he was purged from his old sins.
Add to your faith virtue. We have been justified through faith. It has been declared in heaven. Even our sanctification has been declared, our holiness in Christ. Peter says, for this reason. What reason? That we have been declared justified and holy in heaven. For that reason, we participate by adding things to the faith we have obtained, virtue, kindness, etc.
Wherefore, the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. For if ye do these things, ye shall never fall.
This is what is referred to as working out one's salvation, not to obtain it, but to make it on earth as it has been declared in heaven. Sanctification is a doctrine taught all throughout the New Testament epistles. The doctrine of God putting a dream seed on the inside of you and you working to make that dream come true is not taught in the New Testament. It's not taught in the Old Testament. It's not taught in the Bible.
That's actually part of the nature of God, because God lives outside of time and space. So he's a now God. Everything happens in the now. We want it to happen in the now. If you take me to Disneyland and ask me to wait for an hour and a half in line, I'm like, where's the fast pass? I just want to get through this. I'm not enjoying this. And my wife's like, just enjoy the line. Enjoy us in the line. Let's spend time together. And I'm like, no, I wouldn't be on the ride. Like, for me, I'll set the goal of being on the ride, not being present in the now moment, because my now is the ride, not being with my family.
The Bible doesn't say what he just said. He's just talking. This is a guy talking.
And so I have to learn how to adjust my expectations. And I think about the Bible, you know, there's so many of us, when you read the Bible, that we don't think about that God gap. We want to do something with what God's put inside of us, and we're trying to manifest it with our own strength, our own talent, our own ability. But God's like, I put a seed inside of you that you cannot make happen.
Where did God say that, Sean? In all of your studies of the Bible, where did God say that he put a seed on the inside of us, in the sense that you're talking about a seed? A seed for a music CD or a business or a sitcom or any of that. These are all worldly things, Sean, material things. The Bible teaches that he places his Holy Spirit inside of us, and the Holy Spirit makes us holy. That is what the Bible teaches. It doesn't teach anything you've said so far in this, well, whatever it is.
Because I've chosen you, and you are incapable of the fullness of this without me. Meaning there is a deficit in you that only God could fill. But
a deficit of righteousness. We had none. Zero. This is what the Bible teaches. In Psalm 118, among many other places. Remember, Sean kind of referenced Psalm 118 earlier, but he's never read Psalm 118, obviously. And he's teaching us a book he's never read.
Ooh, Rainbow Land!
The new Shrinky Dink's Rainbow Bright playset by Colorform.
Rainbow Bright?
First, color the Rainbow Lamb characters. Cut them out, then into the oven, and they shrink like magic. Put them on stands, and you're ready to play in Rainbow Land.
Beware, murky and murky. Yeah!
And for more fun, here's the Rainbow Bright Robin Play Transfer Set to create your own Rainbow Bright action poster. The Shrinky Dink's Rainbow Bright Play Set. Some assembly required. It's Colorform's fun.
You plus God equals fullness.
Well, wait a minute. You plus God equals fullness?
You plus God equals fullness.
God is full in himself. What are you talking about, Sean? I think you do believe the Todd White, Bill Johnson heresy, the little God's heresy.
You plus God equals fullness.
I know, Sean, that's blasphemy.
You without God equals a measure of success that will never satisfy you in whatever area it is you're going after.
The wrath of God, eternal conscious torment, that's what the Bible teaches. Jesus said in John 3:36 that whoever believes in the Son of God has life, but whoever does not obey the Son, the wrath of God abides on him. None of what Sean is saying is in the Bible, and much of what he's saying is in direct contradiction to the Bible. If you're following this man, you're following a man who contradicts the Word of God. If you're sending him money, you are partaking in his evil deeds. That is what the Bible says.
And I think of it this way in 1 Corinthians 1, 26, 27, 28. Paul says the Corinthians who think they're like the it church of the world, they are like the hub. And he says, not many of you who were the brightest bulb in the, you know, in the house. Not many of you, you were people who weren't highly educated, who weren't from royal families, who weren't influencers in society. But God chose you, he says this directly, the weakest things of the world, so that those who are wise would be shamed in their wisdom, because you're going to be raised up in a wisdom they can't even comprehend or relate to.
I don't know. It sounds like something might be missing from Sean's exegesis of 1 Corinthians 1.
For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through wisdom did not know God, it pleased God through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. For Jews request a sign, and Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified. To the Jews, a stumbling block, and to the Greeks, foolishness. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God, and the wisdom of God. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For you see your calling, brethren.
Now, in context, Paul is talking about being called to salvation, not called to write a song, not called to start a business, not called to get your wife pregnant, called to salvation through the message of the cross, the message of Christ crucified for the sins of his people.
That not many wise, according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise. And God has chosen the weak things of the world to put to shame the things which are mighty, and the base things of the world, and the things which are despised God has chosen, and the things which are not, to bring to nothing the things that are.
Now, Paul is talking about two things here. He's talking about the cross, how God had chosen a foolish thing like a cross, literally in the Greek, a stick driven into the ground. And the preaching of that cross, the foolishness of it in the world's eyes. But he is also talking about us, the foolishness of us. Not only has God taken a stick and put to shame the wisdom of this world, he is creating a holy people out of dead, wicked, unrighteous people. Dead people, you can't get much more foolish and weak than being dead.
That no flesh should glory in his presence. But of him you are in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God, and righteousness, and sanctification, and redemption. That as it is written, he who glories, let him glory in the Lord.
Justification, sanctification, and glorification, the future redemption of our bodies, the gospel. That is what this passage is about. It's not about God adding himself to you to make those dreams on the inside of you a reality. It's not close to that. It's not that. That is not what the text says. Sean is lying to us. He's lying about what the Bible says.
So in other words, a lot of things that are inside of you, it's going to take a formation of you plus God, learning who he is inside of you, the identity process that creates the fullness of what you need to be to manifest that place that God has chosen just you to manifest. Again, whether it's through your life and family, whether it's through a career, whether it's through a ministry, there's things that are missing and you don't want to despise what's missing. Some of you might be going, but if I just had a benefactor to give me money, I could get there faster. The reality is that you have the ability to produce the resources and wealth inside of you.
Now, Paul in 1 Corinthians is talking about righteousness. Sean says we have what we need inside of us to accomplish what Paul said is being accomplished in 1 Corinthians 1. So in effect, what Sean is saying then is that we already have the righteousness that we need. But God said he did all of this, provided everything needed for justification, sanctification, and glorification, so that no flesh would glory in his presence.
You have the ability to produce a relationship network you need inside of you, but you have to grow in God for that to happen.
So you just add God to what you already have. This is sick.
doesn't mean you won't need other people, but it means you don't need them in the context more than you need God, and more than God wants these things to happen for you more than you even want them to happen. And you need to understand that so that you don't strive. And striving is one of the worst things we can do, trying to make something happen in our own strength and trying to work for God instead of with Him. I mean, you start to work so hard. You outwork God in your life, and you will be so tired, your adrenals will be fatigued.
Your adrenals will be fatigued? What? Sean is not talking about sanctification here. He's talking about, you know, your dreams and stuff. I don't know if I can stand much more of this.
You need to let God be God. Sometimes that means to wait. Part of not despising small beginnings and is learning how to really, really, really wait on God. Another thing in small beginnings that happens is that we want the bigger audience, the bigger crowd, the bigger impact, the bigger influence.
That small beginnings reference is from the prophet Zechariah. It's a prophecy of Christ. You know, the one who came in the flesh to save His people from their sins. But that's not something Sean Boltz talks about, apparently. I feel like I'm not only injuring my brain, but my sanctification listening to this, so let's speed him up. What do you say?
And so we don't enjoy, like, when we made this much money.
We don't enjoy that because we're looking to make this much money. Or we don't enjoy when we have this much social media following. Or when we have this much influence in this area. Like, this many people have listened to our studio. This many people write our books. Or this many people have, you know, been impacted by our family or our home.
Our expert on all things shrinking.